Penguin Random House Audio presents Micromastery, Learn Small, Learn Fast, and Find the Hidden Path to Happiness by Robert Twigger. Read for you by Roy McMillan.
The Memory of Rabia Basri, 714 to 801. The creative scientist needs an artistic imagination. Max Planck, 1918 winner of the Nobel Prize in Physics. What is micromastery? Start with the egg, not the chicken. YouTube has clips of The Great Egg Race, a long-running TV show in the 1980s hosted by an amiable German-born egghead called Dr. Heinz Wulff. Like a forerunner and more inventive version of Scrap Heap Challenge, contestants had to build a gadget with limited resources to meet the challenge set out at the start of the show. In the early series, all the tasks involved an egg that mustn't be broken, the first task being to make a machine to transport an egg the furthest distance possible using only paper clips, card, and rubber bands. It was such a simple idea, yet it gave rise to incredibly inventive machines. And it all started with an egg, something rather small and humble. Life can be overwhelming. We want to do as much as we can, see the world, learn new things, and it can all get a bit too much. I reached a point in my life when I felt that I could no longer be interested in everything. I had to shut some of life out, and I didn't like that. I was living under the assumption, the false assumption as it turned out, that to know anything worthwhile took years of study, so I might as well forget it. But something inside me rebelled. I still wanted to learn new things and make new things. They didn't have to be big things. I was happy to leave that till later. Start small. Start humble. Start with an egg. So I was thinking about how long it would take to learn how to cook really well. I recalled a chef telling me that the real test is doing something simple, like making a perfect omelette. Everything you know about cooking comes out in this simple dish. So I decided to switch the order around. Instead of spending 10,000 hours learning the basics of cookery and then showing my expertise in omelette making, I'd start with just making an omelette. I really focused on making that omelette. I separated it from the basic need that cooking usually fulfills, filling my stomach, so that it now occupied a special, singular place in my life. It had become a micromastery. A micromastery is a self-contained unit of doing, complete in itself, but connected to a greater field. You can perfect that single thing or move on to bigger things, or you can do both. A micromastery is repeatable and has a success payoff. It's pleasing in and of itself. You can experiment with the micromastery because it has a certain elasticity. You can bend it and stretch it, and as you do, you learn in a three-dimensional way that appeals to the multisensory neurons in our brain. It's the way we learn as kids. You never absorb all the fundamentals straight away. You learn one cool thing, then another. You learn a 360 on a skateboard or how to make a crystal radio. My father was a teacher, and he hoped to encourage me when he told me that he would buy me the parts to make a transistor radio when I could explain how a transistor worked. My interest died immediately. I knew how to make the radio and have fun with it, but having to explain it was something difficult, adult, and alien. And wrong. Dad, I forgive you. Hungarian psychologist Mihai Csikszentmihalyi has written extensively about flow. A state in which time seems to be suspended because our interest and involvement in what we're doing are so great. Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi, Flow, The Psychology of Optimal Experience, Harper Perennial, 1990. A micromastery, because it is repeatable without being repetitious, has all the elements that allow us to enter a flow state, which produces great contentment and enhances physical and mental health. Learning a micromastery doesn't commit you in that deadening way that buying a beginner's textbook does. By its limited nature, it gives you permission to remain interested in the world. It doesn't mean you have to commit to doing that thing for what feels like forever, and at the same time, it spares you any worries that you've wasted your time. Do you know the feeling of doing an introductory course on something which you give up on, and then a few years later try to tell others what you learned but you can't remember? A micromastery isn't like that. It's with you forever. And it's nice to have something to show others. For instance, if you learn a martial art, you need something to shut people up with when they say, "Go on, show us a move." A micromastery has a structure that connects in a crucial way to important elements in the greater fields it is a part of. It reveals relationships and balances in the elements of the task that mere words and explanation, textbook style, cannot. Its repeatability and gameability, people like that omelette, ask for another, you start to aim higher, turn it into a self-teaching mechanism where experimentation within certain defined limits greatly increases your learning. But let's get back to starting with an egg, or two. Here's how to make that omelette. Separate two eggs. Trap the yolk in one half of the shell. Room temperature eggs are best. Beat the whites to make a foamier mix. Heat the pan, medium to high heat. Blend the yolks back into the mix. 1 teaspoonful of oil, 1 teaspoon-ish of butter into the pan. Pour in the eggs, use a fork to keep mixing, agitate the pan on the stove. Score lines in the mix with a fork. Let the mix flow to fill in the gaps. Fold it in half. You can also fold it into thirds. Heat for a few moments more, then serve. Before taking it off the heat, watch it rise a little. Once you've done that, you can start experimenting. One egg, or two, or more. Vary the heat. Change the fork action. Beat it less. Use all butter or all oil. A chef gave me the tip about using the fork to bulk up the omelette. I kept practicing. I went online and found more tips. Then a French woman told me about separating the yolk from the white, which allows your omelette to double in thickness and softness. When it's served, people simply go, "Wow!" This is what I call the entry trick. Every micromastery has one. It is a way in one stroke to elevate your performance at that task and get an immediate payoff, a rush of rewarding neurochemicals, which is a nice warm feeling. In some micromasteries, the entry trick is huge, an integral part of the whole thing. In others, it just gives you enough of a push to get you going. There are lots of big-shot learners out there boasting of their ability to master foreign languages, get calculus down, or absorb C++ programming. But they all seem to miss this point. Learning must not be like school. It must not be boring. It doesn't need to be silly fun, but it mustn't be deadening or dull or too hard. The entry trick, in one fell swoop, sweeps all that away. A great entry trick is used in stone balancing. Maybe you've seen some stone sculptor type doing it at the beach. It looks like magic. Rounded rocks and mini boulders balancing on each other in a seemingly impossible way. The first time I saw such a sculpture, I thought it had to have glue or metal rods inside it, and then I watched a small boy knock it over. When I attempted to help rebuild it, the sculptor showed me the entry trick. You can balance any stone at all, but you must find 3 raised bits close together on one side of the supporting stone. 3 bumps, 3 nodules, or even 3 grains. They can be tiny, almost invisible. In fact, the smaller they are, the better it looks. These 3 bumps act as a flat triangle for another curved object to fit into. That's how you make these crazy balances work. People look for flat bits on the stones to make them stand on each other, but that doesn't work, because nothing in nature is really flat. Stone balancing is not only fun, but also a perfect form of micromastery. It is complete in itself, but it could also lead you further into the greater world of sculpture and outdoor art, should you want to go there. The trick is to find 3 bumps on one side. These form a triangle you can balance the stone on. If you only have 2 bumps, you can cheat. You can insert a tiny, tiny piece of grit as a 3rd bump. Perfectly regular stones can be great. It looks so smooth because it's regular, but if you look really closely, it's actually rough and lumpy. Another trick is to balance 2 stones at once. This way you can get some dramatic overhangs. anyone can do it. We envy the person who has a perfect French accent, who can roll a kayak, perform a double or even triple integral in maths, or compose a poem that isn't laughable, who can draw something well, do a magic trick, or lay a brick wall that doesn't fall down. These are perceived as hard things to learn that signify a greater mastery of the field concerned. But with micromastery, you start with the test piece and then, and only then, do you go back upstream to explore more. Why? Because the biggest reasons for not achieving anything are giving up, failing to gain momentum, and becoming distracted.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.